So let's now start the fourth part of this lab session. So I'll stop this webcam. So in this first lab, we will interact with the physical button on the board. So the user button, it's a very small blue button on the board, and with also one of the two LEDs that are available to the user part, are connected internally. So the idea will be to use first two software buttons and one software LED. So this will be turned on when we will click on this button, and also on when we will press the user button on the board, the physical button. And on the other side, pressing this button will turn on or off the physical LED on the board. It's the red LED that we will use. So this will be give you a good view, in fact, on how to interact in both ways, from the board to the user interface and from the user interface down to the board. So let's go back to the layout first. We'll update our layout in the second screen. So this is the first screen. I go to the screen view and go to the second screen, and we will add all the buttons and that we need, and also the image that we need. So we'll add the first flex button. So the naming is here is very important. So be careful about this naming. So it's software button, hardware LED. So the software button, the logical one, will toggle the hardware LED. The location is not important for the moment. And then we will use the round button style that we also add. So we can remove, I add a new style before being able to remove the default one. And I can set, so this run button. So the press state is this one. Maybe it's the other way. So the release state is this one, and the press state. By the way, I can also change the. Let's change. You can see that it's transparent in terms of compilation. You can see that here I set the press state instead of the release state for this image, for this button, and also for the other one. So in fact, since it's the other way around, this one is released and this one is pressed. It's not important, but okay, let's do it properly. And on the second screen, same deal. On this flex button, I mixed the two. Okay, then in this one, I must click the checkbox that lock the flex button to the image size, and I will set the text. This is the next step, the text to it. So adding a new style again, a text, and the text will be hardware. Let's position it properly like this, and set the color for the different state. So we will put in white when it's released and black when it's pressed. Maybe it's a bit too high. Okay. And the same for the software button. So I will do a copy paste. So Ctrl C, Ctrl V. We won't see the second one because it's on top. So I can move this one here, align it up not exactly, but like this is okay. Rename it, this time is software button, but software LED. So SW LED, I remove the last characters and set the text to software. Okay, the next step is to add the label for each button. So the text, the name in this case will not be that important, not critical, I would say. So we have a first one. The color is set also in the slide set. It will be 00C8FF. And the name is toggle physical LED. So I use here the default typography, which is Verdana as we saw, and 20 pixels. I could use a smaller one. Yes, in fact, no, I will use a smaller one. And as I said in the previous section, now I should have a different appearance in my text tab. You can see that here at the beginning it was 000. And now I have five widgets, five elements that use this typography, and one element, and two in a few seconds, that use the 10 pixel, the 10 size Verdana font. None will use this one. So at the very end of my application, I will be able to remove this typography, which is the default one, and to save some flash. And I will set here, okay, the name also, even if it's not critical for the label. Maybe it is, we will see. Okay, so I'm done with the first label. The second label, is this one. So again, adding a text box. Text box takes the default font, the default typography by default, the last one you used by default. So C8FF. Okay, let's enter it. So now we are okay, almost okay for the layout. We have our two buttons, the one that will toggle the physical LED on the board and the one that will toggle the logical LED that we will have to define just here. So to define the logical LED, we will use two images, in fact, two images. That's one way of implementing it. We could use also a toggle image widget, which has it is a two-state image, but it's, let's say, it's more complicated than what we need. All we need is to display one image or the other, so the LED off image or the LED on image. So we choose to just add two images and display only one at a time. So the first image. So this time we have to be very precise on the location, because we must not see one on top of the other, and especially it must no, it's not that we not see the on top of the other, but we do not want to see the LED widget moving when turning it on or off. So if they are at the exact same location, it will be perfect. So the LED off is this one and the LED on is this one. So the LED off, I will put it at the location specified in the slide set, so no surprise. And again, the name must be the correct one, which is SW LED off, because this will name also the image in the source code, and we will use this name in our code. So since it's already implemented, we have to stick to the correct name, and the same for the LED on, but this time we will set the widget as not visible. We will uncheck this visible checkbox. If I uncheck it, it's no more visible. So that's what we will do for the on. By default, the LED will be off. So same, the location must be exactly the same as the off version. And then we set the proper image and uncheck the visible. And the name is SW LED on. Okay. So we will set the first interaction that will consist in turning on the software LED. But we cannot implement it directly in the designer. We will implement it in the source code. So first I have to change the label here. It's wrong. It's logical. So first interaction. We will call it software toggle software LED. So this one, this time, no real importance on the name of the interaction. But let's be precautionous. So this interaction is triggered by the button clicked. So when we click the software button, software LED, so it's this one. We want to execute some C++ code. And C++ code will be to call a presenter function directly. So from the view, we signal the presenter that a software button has been pressed. A specific software button, the one that triggers the software LED. So presenter. So this is really C code, C++ code. I mean, you can type as many lines as you want. Not maybe not as many, but you can type several lines. It must just be a C++ formatted code, and it will be a copy paste directly in the execution function of this interaction. We do not need a specific include, and that's it for this interaction. The second interaction is for the hardware button. So we can reduce this one and add another interaction that will be called now software toggle hardware LED. The trigger this time will be still a button clicked, but the software button hardware LED. And the action still executes C++ code, but this time we will call another function, still from the presenter, which will be software button hardware LED toggle. So anyway, any mismatch of the function name will be automatically seen by the compiler. So do not worry, you cannot go into dark places because you missed a name. It will be explicitly mentioned in the compilation window. And that's it for the layout part. So we generate the code to update all these buttons and images settings. it's done, and we can go back to the kubeid. So the kubeid has been refreshed automatically. You can see that if we go in screen run view. So screen run view USB in user in generated, and here we should find screen two view base, and here we can see there should be our new buttons automatically implemented. So this file should not be modified. On the other side, as we said before, but we can go again in the screen two view, we can see that it calls. We can toggle the source and include header, include files, and see that the screen two view inherits from the screen two view base. So all the functions that are enabled in the screen two view base will also be available in the screen two view. Okay. So back to the kubemx, we need to enable an interrupt. The interrupt will correspond to a rising edge of the pin that is connected to the button. So when the button will be pressed, it will trigger a signal to a specific pin that is available in the schematics of the board. So it's connected to a specific pin, so that when we press it, it toggles this pin. It set it to high, and we can trigger an interrupt based on that, so that this interrupt we can then trigger something on the user interface. So first on the model, then on the presenter, and then finally on the user interface and the view class. So that's what we will do now. We will configure the button. So in the system view, so the system view is just next to the pinout. Normally, so it's PC 13 is there. So it's already configured as a user button, a GPIO, GPIO X1. So we do not have to modify it. So in the system view, we go to first the GPIO and take the PC13 to enable the external interrupt with rising edge trigger detection. So this will raise an interrupt when the button will be pressed. We set the pull down resistor so that it turns back to low. One, it has been set to high, and we change the user button. Okay, so this one is already set in my project. It should be also in yours, but it's just in case it will not be. We are defining here how to set it, and then we have to go to the vector interrupt. Okay, so and we have to enable the XTI interrupt, which is also already enabled, set to the same priority of the others. So this one is also set. So let's generate the code. But normally it should not change anything regarding the board initialization. So again, we implemented already everything. We will just enable another compilation flag. So the JFIC is still complaining. We will enable a compilation flag that will define a compilation flag that will enable this code for us. That is already present. So we have several cases. First, the user pressed the physical button. In this case, this GPIO callback will be called. So this is one part of which is under compilation flag. This callback will call the model to tell the model, because the only application can only communicate with the model, to tell the model that a user button has been pressed, and the model will notify its model listener, so it will be the screen to presenter, than the, that the user button has been pressed. If the screen one is displayed, nothing will happen. If the screen two is displayed, then the user button pressed is implemented and will update the screen view, the screen two view, accordingly by changing the image of the virtual LED we have on the screen. So it will toggle between the off image and the on image. So that's one first interaction. Another interaction is when in the screen view, the software button will be pressed. In this case, the presenter will be signaled that the software button has been pressed and decide what to do. And what to do will be to again toggle the software LED. So it can be quite curious that the view asks, in fact, to refresh itself, but it's not up to the view to decide what to do. The view only reports to the presenter what happened from the interface point of view. And then the presenter, if the software button has been pressed, will tell the view to update the image of the LED on the screen. If the hardware button is pressed, that's different. In this case, the presenter will tell the model to toggle the hardware LED, and the model will toggle the hardware LED using the dedicated BSP function that is available for the LED. So let's see what does it mean. So we can close this dialog window. Let's see what it means in the source code. So this flag now is interesting for us. So we will search again, as we did on the first flag, to list all the files that are impacted by this flag. So in the main function, we should have the callback of the interrupt. So this is the callback that will be called when the pin connected to the button will be at high level. Automatically, this function will be called, and the result will not be effectively to call the model, but to change a volatile variable. Volatile because it is updated from an interrupt. So we have to be careful about that. So we have to define this user button as a volatile variable. And this variable will be monitored by the model, still in the tick function. This code is not yet enabled. We will in a second. So this button is monitored still in the tick function, so periodically. So this time is at every frame rendering, not every 20 frame rendering. We will check the value of this but of this this variable, and if it is one, then we will call the model listener and signal it. So it will be the presenter too that is of interest to call the user button pressed. In the presenter, the user button pressed will call the toggle software LED. And you can see that it's the same function that is called when the screen view will call the software button software LED toggle function. So let's finish this one. It will call the button software LED, and in the view, this image, so the software, the LED on. So if the LED on is visible, then we set it non visible, and we set the off visible, and we set the inverse processing otherwise, and then we refresh both areas. In fact, we could only do one of the two because they are at the exact same location and with the same size. So that was the first interaction. The other interaction is when the software button is pressed. We set an interaction, so it is not this time in the screen view, the screen to view, because it has been implemented in the DGV designer. So that's interesting also to show. Here you do not see the interaction that we set when the software button is pressed this code will be in the base class. So in this screen view, screen to view base, you can see here the source code, the C++ code we put in the interaction. So here we call the presenter software, say this one, software button, software led toggle. And so back in the screen to presenter, so do not hesitate to break the video because maybe I'm going a little bit fast. So in the screen to view presenter, so this function will be called. If it's the software button software led, oops, then we'll tell the view to do the same as if the user button was pressed. And if it's the hardware led, then we will call this new function from the model directly, model hardware led. So the presenter has a direct access to the model. It's not a model listener in this case because there is only one model. So every presenter, as soon as it is shown on the screen, as it corresponds to the current screen, has access to the model and can get then call the corresponding hardware led toggle from the model. This will call the toggle led function exactly as a form for the temperature sensor. It will call a function that is defined in main.c, main.c. And in the main.c, you can see that we call the HAL. This is a function that we that set the LED 3, so the red one, to a high level or low level depending on its current state. It's a toggle. So this is what we will enable just now and see the result on the board. Exactly as for the previous lab, we will just add the compilation flag. So here I am in a C++ compiler. So I'm adding this lab step 2 enable compilation flag. And in the C compiler, I'm adding the lab step 2 enable flag also and close. And we will see that this code is now enabled and we can rebuild or just build because both HPP and CPP files have been modified, even only CPP files. So the program will detect them. So it will take a few seconds. So again, all is described in the slide set. All the steps are covered. What files are modified and how they are modified. So this is exactly what I just covered. And this is what we should observe on the board. The build is over, so we can launch the debug session. So I'm stopped at the first instruction. Let's go. And I can go to the next screen where I see my two buttons. So fortunately, yes, we can see that there are two LED here. One is blue, one is red. On the display, on the screen, on your screen, it's maybe not obvious. It will become when I will press the hardware button. So you can see here that this button toggles an LED on the board. It's the red one. And if I press the software button, I control the LED on the board. And if I press the blue button, user button here, I also control the logical LED. So that's it for this part. Can now switch to the last part of the lab, which will be on the multi-language support.